friends know, we have a wonderful congregation. We have a baby in the front row and a baby in the back row. The sound bomb goes off, and they're perfectly quiet. Happy babies. I would like to introduce to you our guest preacher this morning, Canon Kathy Pennybacker from St. Margaret's in Inverness. I know many of you know her. She is going to bless us this day with the word of the Lord. Kathy, may the Lord bless you, may he fill you with power, and may the words you preach today come from the heart and power of our risen Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen. In the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, amen. You may sit down, please. Good morning.
Good morning.
Did you know that today is Rogation Sunday? Anybody know what that is? Between the people in the government. As a matter of fact, after we left, there was a coup that happened and but anyway, we were there right at the end, right before this all happened. I stayed, again, consigned pretty much to the laboratory on the ship. Didn't get a chance to go out and visit the clinics and everything. And I said, I really need to go out and visit the clinic because I want to know what it's like out there in that mission world. Everybody on the ship, by the way, was a missionary, from the boiler room all the way to the CEO. Everybody was there because other people helped them to be there. So they said, okay, well, the last day that we're going to be going out, there really won't be too much for you to do in the laboratory at that time because all the surgeries are over and everything. You can get out on the bus and go to the clinic. So I did. Unknown to me, the day before, the clinic leader had announced that the following day, the day that I was going, they would no longer be treating adults. We didn't have enough medicines. All they had was a little bit of penicillin and some vitamins left, and so they were only going to treat children. This didn't go over well. In the Muslim community and culture, the man, when we have people come to the clinic, the man would be first, and then the younger men would be next, and then the women, and then the younger women, and the children all the way at the end of the line. And so they were very upset that we were going to treat the children and not the men first, like we're supposed to. Their thought, and I guess there's some basis for this thought, is why do you waste time and money and medicines on children who are going to die before they're 5 years old anyway? Which is the truth in that area. But our leader said, no, we will treat children only tomorrow. Okay, so we get in the van. I'm so excited because I'm going out to a clinic the first time. We all get into the van, and they drive us off to the county, to the clinic in Connor Creek. We get to the clinic, and everybody unloads the van. We get out of the van. The van driver has other people he has to deliver to other places, and so he leaves the compound. The compound is closed behind us. We go up to the little room that we used, and all of a sudden, we realized that things were not real good. Kind of scary when we looked out, and in the whole compound, we had like 200 men standing and waiting. No children, no women. At that time, the women came in later, but at that point, no. And so we were in the little room, and our team leader said, I think we better start praying hard. Because about that time, the men were coming up on to the portico and up on to the little porch that was outside the main door, and they began to beat on the door and the windows, and they wanted to get in. They wanted to have the few medicines that we had left. And the faces were faces of anger and hatred. It was scary kind of stuff. So we began to pray, and then we began to sing. And as we sang, a miracle happened. The Holy Spirit came, surrounded us, and then spread out into those that were banging on the doors. And I even have pictures of the changes of the faces that happened. And these angry faces to faces of calm and peace as they were literally moved off the porch, not by us, but by God. They moved off the porch and into the compound. And we prayed and continued to sing for a little while. And then our team leader says, it's time for us to go out and talk. That's why we're here. We come to bring the good news to them. And it's time. Okay, we said we would be obedient, and we would do it. And when he stepped out onto the porch, he was accompanied by two translators. Our team leader was Peter, and our two translators were Paul and John. I mean, you know, how can you say this wasn't God's hands. And so Peter began to say just this. As we traveled around concrete, we saw the devotion that you gave to God. Just as Paul said, I saw your devotion. I saw your religious fervor. I saw how you prayed. Peter says, 5 times a day, I saw that devotion. And I commend your devotion to Allah. Let me tell you that we are also devoted servants of God. Devoted servants of God, Yahweh. Let me tell you why we've come. Let me show you what we have come to do and what we want to share with you. Let us give you what the only thing we have to give. Remember the reading where it says, silver and gold we have none, but what we have we can give to you. That's Jesus Christ. And that's what Peter said. We don't have any medicine. And even with the small amount of medicine that we have, we are not wise enough to know who to give it to. But we have something that's better than medicine. We have the healing power of Christ Jesus in us, and we will come down and we will lay hands on you and we will pray for healing in the name of Christ Jesus, if you will allow us. Well, we started to go down off the porch. About this time the SWAT team came. They heard that there was a riot at the clinic, and they were coming, and they came with their field clubs and began at the outer circle beating people out of the way. And they got right up to the porch, and they were in the process of beating this one man, and John jumped off of the porch and he wrapped himself around this man. He said, no, don't beat him. Don't do it. We are here to bring the peace of Christ to this community. Let us speak words of peace, not of violence. And they stopped. And so for the next 3 hours to a half hours, we prayed for the people of concrete. 2 by 2, that's also very scriptural. 2 by 2, we stood and we prayed. And each one of this group, I think there were probably about 6 groups, had a translator. Our translator's name, by the way, was Max. And he would tell us what the person said when they came forward, what prayer they needed. And then we would pray. I was with Debbie, and one of us would lay hands and pray, and the other would just stay silent and pray in the spirit and pray. Pretty soon, we were praying before Max told us what was wrong, but praying for the right thing. And he said, how are you doing that? You don't understand Wolf or whatever, Sarah, whichever one they spoke. And Debbie says, the Holy Spirit spoke to our heart, and we're doing what the Holy Spirit told us to do. Pray for this person. And so, and of course, all of our translators were Muslim as well. They weren't Christians. And he kind of, And so we continued to pray for 2.5 hours. It's hot in the compound. And the women, many of you have seen pictures of the women with these beautiful headdresses, you know, material headdresses. Well, they took off the headdresses and they held them up like tents over us, because they knew how light skin could take that sun for very long. And they held them up to protect us from the sun. What a wonderful gift they gave us. And so we continued to pray. These weren't warriors doing this. These were nurses and doctors and medical technologists and healthcare workers who had God protecting them and guiding them and leading them to give what we were able to give, which was prayer and healing in Christ Jesus. When we went back to the ship in the afternoon, we were just floating high in the spirit, I mean, all of us. And all that land could have just flown back to the ship. We didn't see any miracles at the clinic, at the compound, but no miracles. We knew that God was there and the Holy Spirit was there. But we didn't see physical miracles. But when we got back to the ship, we went in and blah, 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 and carrying on. About that time, right behind us came the evangelism group from the prison ministry. They'd been out to the men's prison. And they said they were just bowled over by what God was doing at the prison ministry. They saw hands healed, arms stretched out that were healed. People were able to walk who hadn't walked in years. Blind men saw. People who were dumb and deaf and dumb heard and spoke. All this happened in the prison ministry. Along with, I think, 150 men gave their life to Christ. All that was going on the other side of town. Of course, the medical personnel felt that we were responsible for that because we had kept the enemy so busy on our side of town that he didn't have time to go to the prison and take care of the prisoners. And so the miracles, we didn't see them. And I think it's like that a lot in our work in the hospitals and with patients and everything. We don't see the miracles that we bring to these people. They're there, but we don't often see them. They don't stay. They're not there long enough for us to see the miracles. And so we went back to the ship. And Peter says in this scripture, don't be afraid. Don't be intimidated. Keep your heart sanctified in Christ Jesus. And when you're maligned, and people abuse you, don't be afraid. Conduct yourself as sanctified in Christ Jesus, and they will be put to shame. It's a strange thing to be in a situation where you have every reason to be afraid, and yet the peace of God is so, so strong and so powerful that you are not afraid. And it's terrible. Not so very reassuring for others who want to go into the mission field to know that you may have to suffer while you're doing the good work of God. Suffering for the work of God is one kind of suffering. Suffering for the works of men, completely different kind of suffering, and not as pleasant as working for God. Sometimes it's as simple as having our feelings hurt or being talked about, gossiped about. Maybe that's the kind of suffering we have to do. Or maybe it's when the customs agents won't allow you to take your vans and your materials off the ship and threaten you with jail if you try. It might even lead to death in some instances. So when we went to Dakar, it's a different situation in Dakar. The tribes in Dakar were fishermen and farmers. They weren't lawyers. Okay? They loved being in Dakar. The people were gracious and very nice. The mercy ships always go into a country at the request of the president of the country, and they have the authorization from the minister, health minister, to be there. And just go on their own. So we were there and we were ready to get off of the ship. We were in port and off the ship. And the customs agents descended upon us and said, no, you're not going to take anything off of this ship unless you pay an extra fee for the trucks, for each of the trucks and for the equipment and the materials within the trucks. Then you can take the trucks. Part of this outreach is we have an advanced group that goes and sets up everything for us, the different clinics, the different paperwork that we needed, and all the authorizations. So they were there, and they had a van. They were outside the gates of the port with the van. And so they said, the ones inside said, no, we're not going to pay you anything extra. We were invited here to help the people. And that's what we're going to do. And if we have to go and just go to the clinic and only pray for them because you won't allow us to take any diagnostic things with us, then that is what we will do because we promised the people we would be there. So the customs agent says, no, we can't take anything with you. Well, we also knew that in the Muslim religion, they don't touch women. And so the women of the team that went out took the things that they needed for eye examinations. They took all the drops and everything that were needed, the oculars, everything that they needed for eye examinations, and they stuffed them in their pinnacles and walked off the ship with them, knowing that they would be stopped and searched. Brave, brave ladies, brave. And so they went out the gates and got on the van that was out there, and they took them to the clinic. We all followed behind and got taxis and went out to the clinics. The doctors and the nurses began to test for the eyes, deciding who would have surgery and who would not. Those of us, like me, that needed to have equipment in order to draw blood and other things, we had no purpose of being there. But we had a purpose. God had us pray. And so we began to pray in the compound. And all of the people of the area were gathered around watching us, knowing we were praying and thanking God for this opportunity to be there and to help his people. And about 10:30, we heard the horns beeping. Here come our other three bands. We had been praying that the Holy Spirit would find a way to soften the hearts of the Tuscans and let us go. And they did. So here come the bands, and we continued on. And I was able to do my job as a technologist. The suffering and the strength that God gives us in the times that we don't realize, and how we affect others and as a witness to the strength that God gives us. We can't understand these situations sometimes. Couldn't understand why Dr. Barry collapsed in surgery over the person that he was taking care of. He was our next physician doctor, and he was teaching the doctors of the car how to do particular surgeries. And he literally collapsed. And the surgery was stopped, and the nurses stopped and knelt and laid hands on him and prayed for his healing and for his strength so that he could continue the work God had given him to do. Gary got up from the floor and finished that surgery and three more afterwards by the power of God's strength. And the people in that room, the Muslim men and women who were attending that surgery, saw that. That was a witness to them of the power and the strength of God. In John it says, you know, the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot see, but you can. You can see it because it lives in you. You are, we know from Scripture, you are the temple of the living God, the temple of the Holy Spirit. And we're supposed to reach out to people with the spirit of love and compassion. Which leads me to my last story about a local nurse who had gone to the handicap compound. They separate people that are handicapped. And they, as soon as they are very young, put them in these camps. And so she had been going to visit with them and doing what she could for those who were in need. She watched this one young man crawling on his elbows around the compound. And then she began to notice him out in the car doing the same thing, crawling everywhere on his elbows. His name was Muhammad. This is also a God thing. His name was Muhammad. And so she took him wheelchair. Well, actually, she ended up taking him two wheelchairs because the first chair was stolen. So then she took another wheelchair. And by this time, people in Dakar had heard the stories of what was happening with these Christians from the ship. So nobody bothered his wheelchair the second time around. So we didn't know what a message that young man had received because of that. We didn't know. Till the last day that the ship was in dock, the Minister of Health came to visit, along with not the president, but like high official came to. And here comes Muhammad walking up the gangplank. And they knew Muhammad because that for 18 years they had seen him crawling around in the dust on his elbows. And they said, "Oh, Allah be praised, you've been healed." And Muhammad said, "I don't know about Allah, but it wasn't Allah that healed me, it was Christ Jesus." And the minister said, he was like, mouth open. He says, "That's who I praise. It's my Lord and Master, Christ Jesus." Out of the mouth of Muhammad. And so we do, we give thanks to God. And we pray that He will continue to bless us. Almighty God, whose loving hand has given us all that we possess, grant us that we may honor Thee with our substance and remember the account which we must one day give. May we be faithful stewards of Your bounty. May we, through Jesus Christ our Lord, bring to others which You have given to us. And glory to God, whose power working in us can do more than we can ever imagine. Glory to Him from generation to generation in the church, in this church, in Christ Jesus. Amen.
Amen. Friends, would you please